21 million ounces gold in the ground plus 2 billion pounds of copper in the Americas. Amir, gold mining, it's a long time, almost a year we were here in Geneva in our studios. And maybe you give us a little bit of a flavor. What happened in the last year? Like, because you brought up your resources significantly, right?
It was a landmark year for gold mining. In 2017, we completed 3 acquisitions. It's arguably more than I think any junior gold company has done over the last 12 months. And it really speaks to the very aggressive approach we've had, not just over the last 12 months, but over the last 6 years of what has been a very long, unusually long bear market for the gold sector. Yep. And we've really viewed this as a unique opportunity to be able to acquire resource stage projects for significantly less than their discovery value. So the work that has gone into drilling and delineating resources, some cases developing economic studies, we've managed to acquire for, again, a fraction of the work done. So you're right. I mean, I think it was definitely another very busy year, one of our busiest years as a company. But it, again, it speaks to the character and identity that gold mining has, that we're aggressive and we don't take the bear market as an opportunity to go to the beach, but as an opportunity to be out there working hard, making acquisitions, making deals. And look at the resource portfolio now. You know, it's one of the largest, most diversified gold resource portfolios of any pre-production company in the Americas.
Mm, fantastic. I mean, despite your 21 million ounces of gold you have now together, I mean, also your shareholder list is like the who is who, right?
It's always nice, I think, that as you expand the portfolio and expand your resource base and advance your projects, to also see growth of the shareholder base as well. Because I think it's a vote of confidence. It shows that there's a growing number of institutional and other investors who are joining in. Of course, for us, we're always very proud to highlight the fact that insiders in our company, including myself, are significant shareholders owning over 20%. We've managed to attract institutional capital, especially mining-focused institutional capital, whether it's the KCR Fund, who's been there since day one, one of Canada's largest mining-focused funds, Sprott, another mining-focused institutional management, Extract Capital, Oppenheimer Funds. You see gold and mining-focused funds on the registry, but you also see intermediate gold producers like Centerra Gold and IAM Gold. And last but not least, Brazil Invest, another very different kind of investor, very strategic. This is the oldest investment bank and investment house in Brazil. So
gives you superb contact to Brazil, right?
Just, you know, they're door openers. They're in many ways add credibility at the country level, at the local level, just such a household name in Brazil. So again, we check many boxes now with this growing shareholder base that shows many different types of holders, mm-hmm. but obviously all I think is a great endorsement for the company's both business plan and execution of the business plan thus far.
Mm-hmm. If you talk about business plan, we have now here this beautiful map of the Americas, I would call it, yeah? And maybe you can give us a short idea, what made you to go, let's say, from Alaska to the US, Canada, down to Colombia, Brazil?
Well, first of all, it's a journey that has taken many years. So of course it didn't happen overnight. And as an entrepreneur, I very much believe in focus. That's why when you look at our company, Gold Mining, we started life, as you know, as Brazil Resources. We were very focused on Brazil. And with focus, we were able to build a great foundation. And from that great foundation, we felt that it was time to really take on a bigger vision, a bigger goal, and to go after just great deals. We didn't want to limit our deal-making capabilities by borders. We felt that as long as we were in solid mining jurisdictions that in the future you had a clear path forward for development and production, and we could buy them at attractive valuations, that we wanted to be truly more international. Of course, we're not all over the world. With the Americas, we cover enough ground while still having sort of some synergies in terms of time zone, et cetera. Of course, this is also the same kind of footprint that Uranium Energy, the other company that I've built over the last decade, also has. And truly you can see, I believe, also in diversification. So it's important to have a strong base, but from that strong base to have a bigger footprint, a more international vision. And that allows you to find better deals for your shareholders and creating longer term shareholder value. But again, look at where we are. Every single place, whether it's the US, Canada, Colombia, Peru, or Brazil, these are mining countries. These are mining areas that we're in.
Long history.
Long history, established geologic endowment, infrastructure, mining code, and again, a very clear understanding that these are places that in the future you can develop and you can move these assets forward.
Mm-hmm. Moving assets forward, this is a fantastic thing. Before we come to that, I would love to talk about how cheap you put the portfolio together, because I think you spent like, what, 80 million for a face value of, what is it, the NAV value is 822 million, yeah, which is, I mean, it's outstanding. You bought it for 10 cents on the dollar, it looks like.
Yeah, I'm laughing because, you know, I just... I love this business. I love this resource business because it really is about appreciating the cyclicality of the business. And it's amazing to me that the same assets could be worth basically cents on the dollar or 10 cents on the dollar with this, just the sheer difference of sentiment and commodity price. Mm-hmm. That at $1,100 gold, you can buy the same assets that were worth 10 times more at $1,500 gold. And you don't have to go far more than this slide that you have there to see that with gold mining, we've managed over the last 6 years at an average gold price of around $1,200, make $80 million worth of acquisitions. And if you look at those acquisitions and what their historic market caps were in 2010, 2011, it's nearly 10 times that at over $800 million. So it's... you know, as an entrepreneur, and I think as a shareholder, you can appreciate to some extent that these opportunities could be available. But the fact that we've managed to really pounce on these opportunities, put together and assemble this portfolio, I think is very exciting. It's also exciting to think about the fact that gold mining, since its birth to now, has lived in a sub-$1,400 gold environment.
Exactly, yeah.
Johan, my gosh, can you imagine what our world is going to look like if we once, it's like this baby that's been born and has lived in a certain environment all these years. And what's going to happen when we finally see a world above 1400?
Exactly.
Above 1500.
A real bull market.
So I think it's very fascinating and it's exciting.
Yeah, great. You just said it some minutes before to develop now the company. And we have here a beautiful photo of your Brazilian São Jorge deposit, which I would call is one of the future production opportunities. Maybe you want to comment a little bit on that. And we have also the numbers of the PEA here.
Well, you know, I think if I go back to 2013, and I mean, just to remind you or your audience, I mean, for me, again, as an entrepreneur, I had the experience with Uranium Energy, where we went from a business plan to production in 5 years. Mm. And that was in a uranium business, a very tough uranium business, where permitting was really key. And one of the important takeaways for me that very much applied to wanting to buy São Jorge in 2013 was recognizing that social licensing and permitting plays such an important role in building a mine these days. Anywhere in the world. It really doesn't matter if it's Brazil or Texas or Alaska or Peru. And as I learned more and more about Brazil and the opportunities to build mines there, I recognized how challenging social licensing could be, especially if you have artisanal miners, or as they call them, garimpos in Brazil. And in 2013, I really fell in love with São Jorge because I really appreciated the fact that this project had no active artisanal miners on it, that the project had been kept in such good standing, and garimpos or artisanal miners had been kept away, that the project had great geologic potential, that there was a clear path forward with permitting, and that there was this infrastructure access that you were 2 or 3 kilometers from paved highway and road. And at the time, with the mind and mindset of a mine builder looking at São Jorge, I just felt that this was a cornerstone asset for us. And frankly, in 2013, I didn't think the market would get as bad as it did in 2014 and 15, meaning we could have very well just focused on putting San Jorge and advancing it forward and putting it towards production back then. But when we saw the market get so much worse for gold, we felt, let's keep buying assets. But coming back to San Jorge, you have a project where the indicated grade on the resource is 1.54 gram per ton. For a project that's
open pit,
for an open pit, that's exactly what I was going to say. And you have the fact that since 2013, the Brazilian real, the currency, has basically moved down against the U.S. dollar and other kind of major currencies. So it creates even more of a currency cushion. Labor, diesel, all these other costs have actually come down in Brazil. And it's situated in Pará State, in northern Brazil, where you have the lowest corporate tax rates of any state in Brazil at just over 15%. And so it's really, again, checks all the boxes, Johan, where we have, in my opinion, you can see again that there's a very robust grade and resource to start off with. Metallurgical work that were done shows 93% recoveries. Favorable economic characteristics and a large land package of 50,000 acres that only maybe 20% of which has been explored. So also lots of room for exploration upside. So this is a project that I'm very excited about. It's a project that we believe would be a development project for gold mining moving forward. And again, as we look ultimately to focus our attention on development as opposed to acquisitions, this definitely, in my opinion, stands out neck and shoulders above many projects that are in Americas at an advanced stage of development. I think it's a very competitive project.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think also with $120 million approximately development cost, I think with having your shareholders on board, I think that's an issue which is absolutely doable.
Very competitive project and very good points.
Yeah, perfect. Let's come to your second, I would call, production scenario. What I like with that is because we were now talking only about gold, but here comes now also copper in the play. Yeah, La Mina in the Micauca belt. Maybe you want to comment shortly about the copper option here?
Well, you know, we've been looking at gold copper porphyry projects as a style of deposit that we wanted to acquire. Since 2015, where you know, copper was closer to $2 a pound rather than over $3 per pound. And the mindset was that gold copper porphyry projects are by definition, tend to be very large. Mm. They tend to be lower grade. But these tend to be company makers because of their size, because of the long mine life, and because of the more straightforward metallurgy and conventional way of mining. But Yuan, in a bear market, they're completely out of favor. Mm-hmm. So perfect time to buy them is really our thinking. And Colombia is really one of the last kind of regions in the Americas, in the Andes, when you look at from Chile up to Peru and into Colombia, where the mid-coca belt in central Colombia is very lightly explored, it's underexplored. And there's been great exploration success and results here over the last decade where about 100 million ounces of gold has been discovered, a lot of gold copper porphyry systems. So it's just really an exciting belt. And you've seen a lot of interest in the area. You've seen majors come in, investments being made. And we've made two acquisitions here, Titi Ribi and La Mina. I think it's still early days here in the sense that we were just really seeing these projects as being, having great exploration upside still, and that they're still very much underexplored. But it's great that we can also sit back and say, hey, there's 243-101 resources already defined between Titi Ribi and La Mina, that there was in 2013 a preliminary economic assessment done by the company that we acquired in Colombia, the company called Bellhaven. And so all of this is great to have as a starting point. Mm-hmm. And a starting point in the case of the La Mina project that shows, again, at reasonable commodity prices, $325 copper, $1,400 gold, a project that has doable and robust economics. But having said that, again, I still see really exciting exploration upside and development potential in Colombia. And I also like the fact that we've now combined two previous companies that were separate. You know, Titi Ribi used to be a company called Sunward Resources. La Mina was part of Bellhaven. These two companies or projects were about 7 to 10 kilometers apart. And we've now consolidated all of it. So we feel there's also administrative, geologic, and other synergies that this consolidation brings as we look to kind of advance and move forward. But again, when you look at each and every part of our asset, it's almost like these were company makers on their own. And of course they were, because every single one used to be a company, and now we've brought it all under one umbrella, under one banner. So a lot of stuff we can talk about, almost every corner of this portfolio.
That's right, super. That sounds really fantastic. Maybe a quick note on the analysts which cover you, because I see price targets $4.50 and you are $1.20. What's up?
I think it's a strong vote of confidence to have some of the best sort of resource-focused analysts out there, metals and mining-focused, covering the company for a number of years now. You have them up on the slide there. And again, speaks to the long-term value and the intrinsic value that we've created in the company, where you see these types of target prices relative to the share price. But I would say this is also speaks to this very aggressive strategy we have, where we're constantly moving the portfolio forward. This year, we're still excited about the fact that we haven't released the 43-101 resource on our Yellowknife Gold project. So there's some exciting news flow coming as well with new resources. Just when you thought 21 million ounces was really large, guess what? There's more being added, and not through new acquisitions that we've made already, but haven't completed those estimates. So, and I think these analysts and our shareholder base are just happy to see a very active company, well-financed company, that can continue to move forward balance of this year and next year with the driver's seat. Being in the driver's seat, delivering a lot of good news.
Fantastic, great. Amir, thank you very much for the update, and well done, I would say, develop it further.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, that was Amir Adnani, the founder and chairman of Gold Mining. And you heard it, 21 million ounces gold already in the ground, plus 2 billion pounds of copper. And the company is doing very well and moving really nicely forward. Now have two production possibilities in the portfolio in addition. So I would say check out the company. I'm your host, Jochen Steiger, in partnership with Dukascopy TV, and thanks for watching us. Bye-bye from Geneva.